he and his wife ran the grocery store, and she always said in later years that I was the best kid they ever had.
Was there any talk after you graduated high school about attending college?
No, my father, in the Greek grocery store, they used to call me the Ovreo. Ovreo in Greek means the Jew. It wasn't an act of derision, I don't think, but that's what they called me. We're getting back to after high school. I'd say I was moderately smart. Not terrific, but I could, things came to me easy, and I could always get my homework done during classroom hours mostly. But I wasn't ambitious. After high school, I went to work for my father in the store. After Mr. Ball, and I didn't do much of anything.
Oh, so you worked at the grocery store of Mr. and Mrs. Wall?
Yeah.
For how many years would you say? Like
maybe a year.
A year, and then after that. This was after your graduation.
Yeah.
Then you started to work for your dad.
No.
Oh.
No. I had a cousin of Effie's, a nephew of Effie's by the name of Phil Graw. And he got a job at a printing company that printed sausage casings. And my father used to say to me, "You're a bum. Look, Phil got a job, and you ain't doing nothing. You're a bum." So Phil said to me, "I'll get you a job where I work." So he got me a job, 40 hours.
Printing?
$12 a week.
What were you printing?
Sausage casings. You know, what the things they stuff the sausage in?
Sausage casings.
Casings. You know,
yes. What do you print on the sausage casing? Like the brand?
Yeah, Hebrew National, Oscar Mayer, or whatever. And you used to have to stand at one end of a press, and there was a pressman, a Polish pressman, on the other end of the press who was the pressman, and he used to feed the sausage casings into the press, and they'd come out. They were wet, so you'd have to grab them as they came out and put a blotter on top of them all night. And it was from 12 at night to 8 in the morning.
You were working from midnight till 8?
Yeah.
How long did that go on?
Well, I'm not coordinated. So besides being a terribly boring job, I didn't catch them as they came out, and they would pile up and get all smeared. And the pressman got paid by the thousand or something, and he used to scream at me in Polish, you know, "You're dumb, you don't know how to, you can't catch them." I couldn't take it very long, so I stayed. I couldn't take working all night.
I can imagine. So you had a lousy job, and you were working all night, and you were catching sausage casings that were being printed upon
as they came out of the press.
And this made your dad happy.
He didn't care. And while I was dead, about the second week after I had this job, I said to myself, "It's too tough to go on a streetcar at midnight every night, so I ought to have a car."
So what were you, 19 years old?
I was about 18? I was about shortly after I got out of high school. So on Stony Island Avenue, there were a lot of car places. So I went into one, and I said, "I want to buy a car." So he says, "How old are you?" said 21. So there was a car.
That wasn't the truth, was it?
No. It was a DeSoto car. I bought it for $25. $5 down and $5 a week. And then I was afraid to take it home because my father would holler at me. So we used to hang around a drugstore on 73rd and Bennett. So I took it and I parked it by the drugstore. And then I used to go take it for a ride every day during the day because I couldn't drive it at night because the lights didn't work. So one day my father called me in. He says, "What's this, Charles? I heard you bought a car." I says, "Yeah, I need it to go downtown at midnight." He says, "Are you crazy?" And he took me back to the car dealer. And he says, "You got no business selling my son a car. He's a minor." And so the guy gave me back my deposit.
How long did you use that car to go print sausage casings?
I never used it once. Because I had to go at night.
Had no lights.
And then
I had no lights.
The lights. I just had it by the drugstore for about four nights or five nights.
So that was a very short. That was your first car of your whole life.
My first car.
You only had it for a week or less.
Maybe 3 days or 4 days. Of my first job.
All right, so how long did you last at the sausage casing company?
Maybe 5 months.
All right, 5 months. Now you're about 19 years old?
About 18 or 19.
Okay, what was your next job?
My father said that if I would go to clothing designing school, he would pay for it.
Clothing design?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Huh?
That's when you decided to do that? You went to school to learn how to design clothes?
Yeah. Yeah. So I
that was in 1936.
About 36, 37. I used to get up in the morning, go every morning. And I remember the guy's name, Mr. Bell.
What school?
Charles J. Stone School of Clothing Design.
It was a real building, a school, or just
It was on Madison Street in Chicago, in a big building. They had Mr. Bell and a woman. He used to teach men's design, and she used to teach women's. And I went there for a couple of years, but I never graduated because my dad didn't like to pay the premium, the tuition. But I learned how to make patterns.
You learned how to cut?
I learned how to cut. I could measure you at that time. And from my measurements, I could make a paper pattern.
So that was useful. Is that when you started working for your dad? After that?
At the same time, I worked for him in the afternoon, yeah. He was very proud of me because I made a pattern for a pair of pants and the pants fit okay.
Very nice. Now, how long would you do that for before you did the next thing?
A couple of years.
Oh, just a couple of years?
Yeah.
So that brings you to about 20 or 21.
About 20 or 21. But I never got the certificate. I didn't finish.
So what did you do when you changed? You were working for your dad, and around 2021, you changed your job?
My dad had put in men's furnishings in the store, and I was taking care of the men's furnishings.
What does that mean?
Shirts, ties, and socks, whatever a man wears.
Clothes.
So I used to take care of those items. I did that for a couple of years, and then I didn't like it because he didn't like to pay anything. I was always...
He wasn't real free with the money, huh?
No, so I bought my next car.
When you were about 21, 23?
No, about 20 maybe.
20.
19 or 20. It was a Model A Ford. You know what that is?
Was that an old car by that time?
Yeah, it was about 10 years old.
Mm-hmm.
It was a Model A Ford.
It's your second car.
It was my second car. I paid $15 for it. No, I paid $25 for it.
You really dug deep in your pocket for that one.
I paid it out, $5 and $5 a month. And it was parked in an apartment building next to our house, and it had a for sale sign on it. And I used to go by it all the time. And finally, I got enough nerve to go see the man, and I bought it. And then I drove it around for a while, worked okay. I ultimately drove that car to New York.
Why'd you go to New York?
My father's brother lived there.
Sam.
And I wanted to see New York.
That was Uncle Sam.
I visited with his family.
Yeah, that was Uncle Sam. Okay.
Yeah.
You went on your own or with others?
I went with Effie's nephew, Herman. He was kind of a strange guy.
That was Herman Setback.
Herman Setback, yeah. You know, I don't think you ever met him.
I don't think so either.
Huh?
I don't believe so either.
No. So he and I drove there. We used to sleep in the park.
The park in New York?
He was the original hippie.
On the way to New York, we didn't want to pay money for a room.
Oh.
We took along two army cots. It had a running board. Remember seeing cars with a running board?
Mm-hmm.
And we fastened the cots to the running board.
You must look good going down the highway. So, we could talk a little bit about, so how old were you when you met Pearl?
About 21 and a half, 22.
Yeah, so that's right around here. Right, a couple years after that trip to New York. Didn't you take a trip west?
That was just before I got married to Mother. That was in 41.
Oh.
Well, 40. It was in 40. And so I stopped working for my father. And I answered an ad for a clothing designer. I know a smattering, a little bit, but not too much, about clothing design. And the name of the company was J.B. Simpson. They're still got stores around here. And it was a mail order clothing place. And they hired me.
How long did you work there?
I worked there until I got married.
So how old were you when you started working there?
About 21 or 22.
Right, and you got married at what age?
24.
You were married at 24?
Yeah.
Oh. Is that right, Mother? Oh, you're sleeping, okay. So am I.
Yeah.
I thought you were biting your tongue.
41. I was 24.
You were born in 1970.
17.
And this, you said 1941?
Yeah.
1711, yeah, 24.
So they assigned me, this was a place that had a few hundred employees, and they had a designer and an assistant designer, and they hired me. I was the assistant to the assistant designer. And they gave me a title, the assistant designer. That's where I met my good friend, Herbie Brusky. He was in charge of the button boys, the people who matched buttons to cloth. and I worked there until I got married.
So how?
After I got married.
So how did you meet Pearl?
I heard about Hadassah. Hadassah?
Yes.
It's a ladies' charity organization.
Mm-hmm.
Jewish ladies.
Huh? Jewish ladies. And there was an, they had an organization called Junior Hadassah. And they were young people. And they used to always have brother and sister dances. And Pearl used to take me to the brother-sister dances because I had a car and I could take the girls home.
Harriet, you mean?
Wait, you don't mean Pearl.
Harriet.
Harriet used to invite me to the brother-sister dances because I could take some of her friends home. And I load up the car with girls and take them home.
Is that your Model A car?
My Model A Ford.
And so this was a pretty good deal for you to get a car full of girls.
Yeah. So one time she invited me to one, and who do you think sat next to me?
Pearl.
Pearl sat next to me. And there were about six or seven girls in the car. So it was a tight squeeze. And then from there we kept on going, and I kept calling her for dates. But I didn't realize that when you dated a Jewish girl, that if you got invited out for dinner, that was it. That was a commitment.
What do you mean if you got up? You mean if you went to the parents' house?
Yeah. So one day I got invited for dinner by Morris. You remember Morris?
Mm-hmm.
My grandfather, Morris.
Yeah. And she invited me for dinner, and I went for dinner, and Ann must have spent the whole day preparing. She made a sumptuous dinner, and I thought I had a wonderful dinner. And then after dinner, I went into the living room, and Morris came over to me, and he put his arm around me, and he said, "Well, son, how much you make a week?" I thought I didn't have to tell him.
Well, how'd you handle that?
Huh?
How did you handle that?
I said, "I do okay." some vague thing like that.
He didn't pursue it, huh?
No. He didn't like me in the beginning.
Why didn't he like you in the beginning?
Because I didn't have an education. I was in a crummy business, tailoring business. And he thought that his beautiful daughter could do much better than me.
Oh, my. So how long after that, when you went to his house for dinner, did you marry her?
Maybe 8 months.
How long after that did you ask her to marry you?
I asked her to marry me shortly before we got married, in September. I took her to a restaurant. I said, "I think we ought to get married." And she said, "Great."
Do you remember the restaurant?
Delezon. D-E-L-E-Z-O-N.
And that was a nice restaurant, I guess.
It was my kind of restaurant. It wasn't too French, too expensive. But it was okay. It was a better than average restaurant.
Delezon.
Thanks, Ma.
She remembers it.
Yes, she does. So that was in September of the year you got married?
Yes.
But you got married on September 14th.
No, that was in, that was earlier. That might have been in July or August.
Okay. That makes more sense.
So you were married in what year?
September 14th.
41.
And you were working at the, you were working as an assistant designer?
Yes.
And then what happened?
I was making $27 a week, and before I got married, my boss said, "You're going to be pleasantly surprised at your next paycheck because we're going to give you a raise before you got married." So the next week they gave me $30, which wasn't a very big raise.
So how long did you make? How long did you stay at that job making $30 a week?
Till I went to the war.
Oh. So you got married in September of 41.
Yeah.
And you got drafted what month and year?
November 11th.
Of 41?
Yeah.
You got drafted in November. You were married in September.
Yeah, we went to Starved Rock State Park for a couple days honeymoon. And when we came back, there was the notice in my mail.
So you didn't even have time to get moved into a household or anything?
No. We moved into a furnished kitchenette apartment for a very short time, about 2 months.
So when they drafted you, that meant that you had to show up for the Army induction. How soon after you got the letter?
Very shortly, on November 11th. When I got the letter, when I got back from my so-called honeymoon, the letter was waiting.
I'm going to stop.
Okay, Dad, we're going to talk about the Army now.
Okay.
And as I understand it, you were married in September of 41, and
yeah.
You were drafted in November of 41.
Yeah, a couple months later.
And then how soon after you got the draft letter did you actually have to make an appearance?
November 11th.
12th.
So, within a week, huh?
No, September, we had 2 months.
Okay. Oh, 2 months. Oh, I see, you got the draft.
Got married September 14th.
When did you receive the draft?
The notice was waiting for me when I got back from Starved Rock.
I get it. And then they told you had a report in November.
Yeah.
All right. And where did you...
Went to Camp Rockford. That's a camp outside of Chicago.
You want to tell us what happened that you ended up in the infantry instead of the officers' corps?
Yeah. Yeah. They sent us to Camp Mineral Wells, Texas. I mean, Camp, I forgot the name of it, would you believe it? In Texas, near a town called Mineral Wells.
What? Is it for her?
No, what was the name of the camp in Texas, bro?
Bakersfield?
No.
All right, so you're in Texas.
Mineral Wells?
I'll think of it. Camp Walters, W-O-L-T-E-R-S, and it was near a town called Mineral Wells, which is where the people came for baths and where they drank the mineral water. And then, in November I went there, and on Thanksgiving Day, I wanted to have a good dinner with a tablecloth dinner. And I went into Mineral Wells at the hotel and sat down to have dinner. And the girl came over and said, "Do you mind if another soldier has dinner with you?" And I said, "No, that's fine." So they brought over a soldier. His name was Sergeant Farrell. I remember his name. And so we had a nice dinner, and we had a nice, went to the show together and went back to camp together. And he said he worked in the classification section of the camp. And he says, "What would you like to do after you get through with this basic training?" And I said, "I want to go where it's nice and warm, where they're not going to send me overseas, and where I could sit out this war not doing very much." That was my military ambition. So he says, "Okay, I'll tell you what, I'll send you to clerk school." And I said, "Fine." I didn't see him until about 2 weeks later when we were taking a aptitude test. And he spotted me. And he came over. And he said, "I took care of that for you." I said, "Thanks." And so when we got through with basic training, I looked on the board, this one's going to Cookson Baker School, this one's going to this school and that school, and the following men are going to the Aleutian Islands. So I was on that list. So I thought to myself, a nice guy. He told me he did it and he didn't have to do it. So I went over to see him. He says, hi, Kraut, how you doing? I says, fine. He says, you going to clerk school? I said, no. I'm going to the Aleutian Islands. He says, that's impossible. I sent you to clerk school. He says, let me check. He went and checked, and he found that I was in Company D, like David. And in Company A, there was a man by the name of Carlton Kraut. And that guy was going to clerk school. And I went back to the base, and I said, who is this Carlton Kraut? I want to meet him. And he was from Kentucky or somewhere, couldn't hardly read or write. Everybody, it was a mystery of the whole company, how come he's going to clerk school? It's so
terrible.
I went back to Farrell and I said, I think you fixed up the wrong guy. And he said, look, he said, oh my gosh, he's in Company A and you're in Company D. And I got to his name first. And I said, what can you do? He says, nothing, if the orders are already out. So my Army career started badly, and I felt that there was a cartoon character that used to be drawn by Al, you know, the guy who draws Little Abner?
Al Cap.
Al Cap.
He used to call him Joe with an unpronounceable second line, all consonants, Bifstick, B-F-S. Yeah.
He had a black cloud over his head.
And walking around with a cloud over his head, because every place he touched, things went bad. And I thought the dead guy was walking in front of me, because whatever happened didn't work. For instance, when I got drafted in Camp Rockford, when they were sending you out to deciding where you're going to go, the first thing they did is they took you in a huge auditorium and gave you an IQ test. That IQ test determined your future to a great extent. And so after the IQ test, they brought all these men back into the auditorium, maybe a few hundred, and they called out five names to go see the psychiatrist, and I was one of the five. And I never liked to be singled out of a group, and so I went into this room where the psychiatrist was, and he had a table with children's building blocks set on the table, and then he would range them three in a row and hold up three fingers. And then he would put three on top of each other and hold up three fingers. And so I figured this was the class for the place for the five dumbest in the class. And finally I got enough nerve. He was walking around. I said, Captain, I feel that test you gave us was for the five dumbest out of this whole group. And he said, yes, your score was a little bit low, and we give you this opportunity to bring it up. I said, well, I don't think, I might have done bad, but I don't think I did that bad. Can you, any way you can check the score? So at that time, they had stencils they put on top of the stores to read them. And he went and he checked the score. And he said, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
He said, you got scored at number 32.
Okay. Jerry, excuse me. Marcia.
Okay, so you scored 32?
Yeah. So he checked the my score with his grid, and he said, oh my gosh, we made a mistake. Your correct score was 132.
These were IQ tests.
Yeah.
And
which is one of the highest scores you can get.
And 32, they gave you a 32 for writing your name.
You could have got out of the Army on a 32.
I wish they would have sent me.
On 132, it was number one.
So, but would you believe it? I was held back with these other five guys or four guys, how many it was, and I was with them all through basic training. We were identified as the dumb guys because we came through last.
So, did that make it easier or harder for you to go through camp?
Much harder, because I was identified as one of the low scorers by the people who.
But you had to work with these four idiots.
So you had no respect.
I used to write letters for one of them. I used to write good love letters to his girls. Yeah.
To their girls?
Huh?
What'd you say?
I used to write love letters for his girls.
They couldn't write.
Yeah.
He couldn't write English good. I remember he was a very pleasant guy, and I used to wonder. So.
What is that? Is that a frog?
No, I said.
Not Clarence Darrow.
Yeah, we lived down the street from him. I'll tell you on his tape.
Okay. Well, you can go ahead and tell us. So you were a delivery boy, so this was in the 30s?
This was in the 30s, yeah. I was a delivery boy for the Greek grocery man, and I had a huge wagon. Not really a wagon. It was a big box on top of two huge wheels that you had to push. You put the groceries in the box and pushed and walked to this one and that one and dropped off the groceries. And we lived at that time on 61st in Greenwood, I think. And down the street from us, there lived Clarence Darrow. He was a famous lawyer. I never met him, and I never was in his house, but I was enamored of him. I thought he was really the greatest. And so when I used to walk up and down the street with pushing my wagon, I used to invent cases and made arguments and to myself. And I won some of the biggest cases that way.
So when you were a kid, you wanted to be a lawyer?
And that was what I was inspired by him, and I think that might have been one of the things that influenced me to later on in life want to be a lawyer.
And how did you even really know very much about what lawyers do or how they argue cases?
I didn't know a thing. I made up the cases in my head, how I defended all these men charged with serious crimes and other things, and I generally won.
And, that's pretty interesting.
I think that was probably one of the background reasons why I ended up in law.
So, but before you actually committed to law, you had to go in the Army.
Oh, that was when I was a kid. I didn't commit to going to law school until I was 40 years old.
Right, and I think we wanted to hear some of your Army stories before we get to the college and law school stories.
Okay.
So, you were first assigned to the Aleutian Islands.
Yeah.
And what do you want to tell us? What's in your mind to tell us about the Aleutians?
Well, the first night we got there, we got off the boat, and I saw a treeless expanse of nothing. No trees, nothing growing, you had to walk on tundra.
It was wintertime?
This was in April. March. March, I think it was, or April.
Carl, are you moving down to Halloween special?
Tundra is a soft,
what?
Spongy, grass-like material that has a lot of curves in it, so it's very easy to fall and break your ankle. And the second or third night we were there, a wind came up like 100 miles an hour. And we were staying in tents, and the tent blew away from us. So there we were, laying on the cots with nothing above us and the wind howling about 75 or 100 miles an hour. And that was my introduction to the Aleutian Islands. It was a barren wasteland, nothing there. And until about a year went by, I was still there. And they finally dug some wells and put some toilets in and made a few comforts of civilization there. Kept on thinking, how could they be so mean as to send people up at a godforsaken place like this? And that way we managed to survive.
What was your mission there?
At that time, the Japanese took over two islands at the end of the chain, Attu and Kiska. And they were afraid they were gonna try to come up the islands and attack us. But they didn't do that, but nevertheless, they used to get us up at 3 o'clock in the morning to go out in the fields and be ready to defend ourselves.
So you were there just as a soldier, private, grunt, kind of a infantry
guy?
Yeah,
I was a private. I was a private, and I used to get on KP a lot. I was very unhappy there. Thinking about my wife at home and everything, and I did a lot of letter writing. I also kept a diary of what I did every day for the 27 months I was there.
I mean,
okay. So I was in the Aleutian Islands, and on the third or fourth day we were there.
Okay, so now we can start over there. You said that on the third or fourth day you're in the Aleutian Islands?
Yeah. A windstorm came up where the wind was blowing about 80 or 100 miles an hour, which was common in the Aleutian Islands. And we went to bed at night with that howling wind. The next, we woke up in the middle of the night, the wind blew the tent away. And we were there in the windy place without a tent, and we had to get up in the middle of the night and try to resurrect the tent so we'd have some cover over our heads. I understand that that's the place where the world's weather is made, and it has the most violent weather in the world. Until we came there, nobody lived up there. It was just a vast wilderness. And so we had to build everything from scratch. Finally, after we were there for about a year, they sent up Quonset huts, which are steel buildings with a round top. And they dug wells and they put in plumbing, and it was a little bit more civilized existence. The winds used to blow so hard, and the snow used to blow so hard, that they would run a rope from where we were living to the mess halls or mess tents, so you could hold on to the rope while you were walking. Because in the event that you didn't do that, you would get turned around and get lost, and you could wander around in the blizzard for a while, until you became ill or something worse happened to you.
Pearl Crowd, Dr. Cotell, had me call you to get a test on the carotid artery.
So after as we got into the spring, weather got a little bit better, and it wasn't so bad in the summer and early fall. But in the winter months, the weather was awful. I don't know how anybody could ever live up there.
What kind of job did you eventually... You started off as just a grunt, right? Just
I started off...
Private first class.
As a private, not first class.
Oh.
And I was on KP a lot. They used to call me K.P. Kraut. and I couldn't get on. Anytime they needed somebody for K.P., they would put me on.
Why did they put you on K.P. so much?
I don't know. Maybe I mopped the floors good.
Oh, it wasn't the punishment.
Could I get it a little later? I'm happy about Tuesday, but I'm...
Wait until Pearl gets through.
Okay.
So.
Okay, whenever you're ready.
So, they finally got Quonset huts up there, made living a little bit more civilized. And I had a typical private's job, used to be on guard duty a lot. And on guard duty, you were on for 24 hours, and you were on guard duty, walking around wherever you had to walk around for 2 hours. Then you got 4 hours to sleep, and they woke you up again, and you did that for 24 hours. And so this one time I was on guard duty, and I was walking around a coal dump, so nobody should steal the coal. In the middle of the night, I was walking around, or late in the afternoon, and presently a Jeep came up, and I said, uh-oh, what did I do now? And the officer came out, and he said, are you Kraut? I said, yes. He says, the major wants you in the office. So they brought out a replacement for me, and I went back in the Jeep. They took me to the office, and there was a major in the office, and he said, you're the guy who writes the newsletter. I said, yes, because every month I used to collect information about the men, and I would write up a little paper that said, this one's heard from his wife, this one did. Little gossip about each of the soldiers.
Did you type it up?
I typed it up, and that time they had the mimeograph machines. They didn't have copy machines. And then I used to copy it on the mimeograph machines and pass it out to the soldiers. And so this major says, you're the guy who writes up that letter every month, aren't you? And I said, yes. He says, "How would you be good enough to type this for me?" And he gave me something to type. And here I went into this room. It was warm, light, cozy, and it was like a revelation. And so I typed it up for him. And then he said, "Here's another one." So he kept me busy the rest of that afternoon. And then the next day he said, "How would you like to come and work over here?" I said, that'd be great. I was very satisfied with that. And so then he transferred me into that company, and I worked for him for about a year and a half.
So for the last year and a half, you had like an office job there?
Yeah, I did. And then he was also the investigating officer who investigated bad things that soldiers did. And you'd have to make up a transcript of questions and answers he would ask them, and then send it to Washington. And so I went and I got a book on court martials, and I read up on this, how you do this. And so even though I don't know how to take shorthand or anything like that, he would take me along and I would make up the transcript, and I would had my own shorthand. Nobody could read it but me. And I would make up the questions and answers in a good form to send it in. And he thought I was very good, and he used to loan me to other investigating officers to help them. So then I remained with him for the rest of the time I was in the Aleutian Islands.
Altogether, how long were you there?
27 months.
And what precipitated your getting off of the islands?
Time to go home.
You were done with the service?
No, I wasn't done. They sent us back in June of 1944. That was the time of the invasion of Normandy, and they needed a lot of troops to go to Europe. They sent us to a place called Camp Shelby, Mississippi. It was near Hattiesburg. And it was in the middle of June or July